Excuse me, I'm going to have to rely a little bit heavier on this microphone today.
Thank you, Elder Gilbert, for leading us in the reading of God's Word. And we have a part two from last week's sermon. And I'd like to address you once again from the topic, When Good Isn't Good Enough, part two. Today, I want to preach to you from the gospel according to Lucia Macbeth. Hers is probably not a name that you know. You may know it, but I want you to know it. More importantly, I want you to know and remember the name of her son, Jordan Davis. Now, if you've been following the news, you probably know that once again, the state of Florida is embroiled in a criminal justice controversy involving the killing of an unarmed teen by an armed adult. Jordan Davis, the teen, was at a gas station with his friends, and you know they were playing their music loudly when Michael Dunn, the adult, approached them and told them to turn it down. Now some words were exchanged, tempers flared, and Dunn, being the only armed individual in the group, shot repeated shots into the car that Jordan Davis was in as they tried to drive away. He claimed that he feared for his life. Jordan Davis lost his life that day. Dunn was convicted on multiple counts of attempted second-degree murder, but the jury was hung on whether or not to convict him on the charge of first-degree murder, which would have held him accountable for Jordan Davis's death. That particular count will have to be retried in the court of law. Now this case, for many people, brings back memories of the state of Florida versus George Zimmerman, and just like that case, there carries some socio-political implications, but I don't really want to get into those in this sermon. I don't want to get into that this morning. In this situation, what leaves the biggest imprint on my heart is a portion of the statement that Lucia Macbeth, Jordan Davis's mother, made after Michael Dunn was convicted. Hear the words of Lucia Macbeth. "It is sad for Mr. Dunn that he will live the rest of his life in that sense of torment. And I will pray for him. And I've asked my family to pray for him. In my heart, I've affectionately named her Saint Lucia. I've named her Saint Lucia because what she expressed in that statement is supernatural. It's supernatural. It was not sourced of herself. It didn't come from her. It came from someplace much, much higher than I think any of us could imagine being in that moment. Her words, to risk being hyperbolic, were nothing short of miraculous. I simply can't imagine that I would be soliciting prayers for someone who had callously killed my child and then ordered pizza as if nothing had ever happened. I can't imagine uttering a sincere, loving, and gracious prayer for a person who, even as the verdict was being handed down, still didn't believe that he had done anything wrong, and still thought of himself as a victim. I can't imagine trying to identify with his torment when I had my own torment to deal with. I can't imagine being able to manage even half a smile as a jury told the state and my family that they could not agree on whether or not my unarmed baby boy was a real threat to this man. Sister Macbeth's poised and godly response simply would not have been my default response. At least I don't imagine that it would be. In short, in that moment, she lived into and embodied perfection. Perfection. Jesus told his followers to be perfect Therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. He was invoking Leviticus 19:2, in which the Lord tells Israel, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord, your God, am holy. Perfect and holy, they're used interchangeably here. Jesus switches out one word for another, but they have slightly different connotations. This is where I get a little nerdy, so just stay with me, amen. They have slightly different connotations. To be holy in Hebrew, kadosh, that means to be orderly, to keep order, to be in good order. It means to be observant. But interestingly, Jesus does not use the Greek word for holy. There is a Greek word for holy, hagios, but he doesn't use that word. He uses the word teleos, which means perfect. It can also indicate completion or wholeness. It's as if Jesus was saying, you can't be holy unless you're whole. Be holy, holy. You get that right? You understood that? Okay, good. We're on the same page. In each of these, you have heard it said statements, Jesus first describes the holy and then demonstrates the whole. He moves from order to perfection. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. First of all, let me get something straight about that. That comes from Exodus 21 and 24. That instruction was about fair and equitable punishment. If someone did something to offend, they deserved a punishment that was equal to the offense and nothing more than that. Listen, if somebody kills your goat, you don't kill their whole family, amen. Somebody snaps on your tennis shoes, you don't shoot them in the face, amen. I mean, you're laughing, but that happens. If someone annoys you with their loud music, you don't shoot into their car, amen. That instruction was more about restraint than revenge. It was about restraint. But clearly, the people didn't get it. They didn't get it. Which is why Jesus says, if anyone hits you on the right cheek, go on and give him the other. Really? If someone sues to take your coat, give them your outer garment as well. Don't resist evil, but let evil know that it has no power over you. It has no power over you. It can't rile you up. It has to show itself for what it is, because you will not emulate it. You're not looking just like it. Listen, if you walk up in the middle of a fist fight, two people are going at it, they're getting licks into each other. How do you know which one is the aggressor if you didn't see it develop? You don't. They look alike in that time, don't they? Mm-hmm. They look the same. Don't give evil so much credit that you both think it can ever actually take something away from you, is what Jesus is saying. A coat is a coat. Money is money. Okay? It's just money. They're ephemeral. These things are temporary. What you have is eternal. What you have is from something higher. Walk away from the need to exert control. Walk away knowing that you're already whole. That's not to say that self-defense isn't, you know, some cases it just, if you can't retreat, then, you know, what are you going to do? I don't want to use this text to victimize people. I want you to understand what this text is saying. Amen. Amen. Love your neighbor and hate your enemy. First of all, that ain't even in the scriptures. It's not in the scripture. It's not. It's a human convention. It's how we do, right? How can you love somebody as despicable as an enemy? But that's exactly what Jesus was telling his disciples to do. Love them because God does. Love them because God does. Be like your Father in heaven emulate your daddy. Not someone who didn't make you. Emulate your daddy. Be like your God, not like your fellow creations. Act like you belong to something higher than yourself. That's what Jesus is saying. The reason our good isn't good enough is because it falls short of wholeness. The reason we miss the mark is because we're striving for the 1 mile and nothing more. Jesus is literally telling us to go the extra mile. That's where that saying comes from, by the way. The text, go the extra mile. It comes from the Bible. He's inviting us to a level of perfection that simply following the law cannot attain. He's inviting us to be like our Creator. It's a high calling. It is a difficult calling, but it is a calling given by one who loves us and wishes for greater communion with us. It's a calling from one who opens his heart so that we may know what's in it, so that we can take a part in what's in it, so that we can adopt it even as we've been adopted. It's a calling from one who gave up glory and put on flesh just so that he could be with us more deeply and more profoundly. It's a calling from one who did more than what was necessary, even to the point of submitting to the cross. Cross he didn't deserve. He went the extra mile, and now he is inviting us all to walk with him. I thank God this morning for Sister Macbeth. I thank God for her. I thank God for how the grace that she showed in that moment convicted me, how it inspired me. I thank God for examples like hers that show us what it looks like to love and pray for our enemies even if they don't turn the other cheek. I pray for her. I pray for Jordan's father, Ron, and as she's asked her family to do, I pray for Michael Dunn. Now may we all find wholeness in God. May we all find wholeness, completion, perfection in the care and the instruction of our Heavenly Father. May we truly, from this point on, look more and more like our Daddy. Amen. 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 Gracious and eternal Lord, we've often chosen to emulate the wrong things. Lord, we want to be more like you. So in those moments when it's most difficult, Lord, we need some strength to do that. When we find it hard to forgive somebody, Lord, remind us of how we've been forgiven. Remind us of the many times we've needed your grace over the course of our lives. Lord, it would be a shame for us to come here this and every week and not be changed. Lord, as we still have breath in our lungs, clearly you're not finished with us yet. Mold us, God. Teach us. Shape us into something that looks more like you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let us sing together.